Well, almost everything has been said. So there's little left for me to say. Except perhaps I should point out that Luciano said that it was very unusual to have a philosopher in this meeting about the unknown. I think it is even more unusual to have a futurist in a meeting about the future. So I am grateful for the invitation, and I thank everybody who helped and organized this wonderful meeting. It really has been two scintillating days. And I thought maybe I should partly reflect on what I hear and try and synthesize instead of giving a kind of standard pet talk. And I thought I should start with this place. This is a very special place. And I don't just mean this hall, I mean this building. It's a quite remarkable building designed by a remarkable man called Charles Kurela, and the Indian architect. If you get a chance to look at his building, I do recommend. They're phenomenal buildings. And this building has a little kind of aura of the unknown. What are these eggs? Or I don't know. I don't know what they are. Somebody said they are an eye. You know, there's kind of a lot of unknown about the building. And part of the unknown, of course, is where the building is located. And I was reading in the beautiful book about the foundation that we all got a free copy of, or at least the participant to the speakers got a free copy of. And it said that Charles Kurela was thinking how he's going to design this building, and he thought of the ocean, and he came to the conclusion the ocean was the kind of the unknown. So he uses the metaphor as the ocean, the vastness of the ocean as the unknown, which is a very interesting metaphor. It's worth reflecting on, and I'll come back to it. But part of the special nature of this place is it is not just the ocean, but also a river, not too far from here. And another part, a special part of this place, is that perhaps this is the only foundation that has a center for the study of the unknown. No other institution has that. Of course, the unknown cannot be studied, so the center doesn't actually study the unknown because it cannot be studied. It studies biomedicine, I think. So there are a number of special places, special things about this place. But let's begin with the river. Now, for most people, the future is really like the river. It's like a mighty river with a given direction that just flows in one direction continuously. And you follow the flow of the river. The banks of the river define the contours, and we just go in this. Occasionally, we come across some, hurdles. We can overcome them. Every now and again, we come across a waterfall. We fall down. But our little dinghy comes up again, and we carry on this mighty river. And many of the presentations we heard during yesterday and today essentially see the future as a mighty river. But let us follow an example of the metaphor of Charles Kurela, and let us assume that the future is not a mighty river, but an ocean. And unlike on a river, on an ocean, we can go in any direction. So here it's an ocean. So this is the future as really the great unknown. You can go in any direction you want, but you do need a certain things. And we know that not too far from here, Vasco da Gama left to discover the unknown world. And we also know that Columbus landed somewhere here when he came back from America, which also makes this place very special. But those of us coming from India may see this special as slightly different, because what Vasco da Gama and Columbus did when they discovered the unknown is not worth repeating, and we definitely don't want to repeat that history. So if we go in this new adventure towards the future, we don't want to end up doing to whatever we discover what Vasco da Gama and Columbus did to the new world. So maybe we ought to be aware of history and understand that we don't want to make the same mistakes. And we also need some navigational tools to guide there. And I think we've had a number of very good presentations giving us these navigational tools, the rule of the law, social justice, human dignity. And Luciano earlier on gave us 5-6 challenges, which I think are the kind of navigational tools that we need. And of course, we need some notion of where we want to go. We don't just want to go anywhere, so we need some kind of vision. It's very interesting that this foundation also has a prize for vision. But of course, it's not the vision as I'm using in the sense that I'm using. Right? So we need a vision of some future notion of some kind of future we want to go to. Right? But 100 years is a very long time. And as we have discovered, people have struggled. You know, how do we deal with this great unknown that is stretching 100 years? So let's try and make it a bit more workable, right? So let's just concentrate on the first 20 years. We come to the rest later. The first 20 years, the future in the next 20 years. Actually, the future in the next 20 years is going to be very much like the present, in the sense that it is not the future at all, it is the extended present. It's extended present in the sense that there are so many trends that are so deeply embedded that they will take us in a predetermined direction. There's very little we can do. So in that sense, the future may actually turn out to be the way it was described, say, by Padma this morning, or by Maria, unless, of course, somebody like me stands up and says, hang on, I don't want a Cisco future. I do not want a future where our behavior is, human behavior is altered. Because if we have a technology that can alter human behavior, I know that I will be the first person on which that technology be used, because I'm a card-carrying full, professional dissident. You know, I object to everything by nature, because most things I see around the world just do not fit my picture of the world. I mean, we talked about inequality, we talked about injustice, we talked about what's going on about to migrants and so on and so forth. If you just simply want to extend that to the future, there's lots of technology, but all these injustices continue, the inequality continues, the dehumanization of human beings continue, then I don't want that future. So you have to make... there'll be a lot more to clap about. So the first thing I want to say is that, yes, that the future that we are talking, that we have heard about, virtually everything that Professor Hershowitz mentioned in his presentation about DNA editing, about cyborgs, actually, it's not about 100 years. It's all going to materialize in the next 20 years, because all these things have already happened. They're embedded. You simply extend. What all we are doing is we are looking at the graph and we are extending the graph to the next 20 years. So the next 20 years is already colonized. And the only way to deal with it is for those who don't believe in colonialism to stand up and say, hang on, we don't want this, right? We want something else. And then we have to define what that something else. So this great ocean of unknown with our ship ready to sail, we've already decided that there may be some objections to certain directions that we want to go. We may not. There may be people who will say, we don't want to go in that direction. We want to go in certain direction. So that's the first cut, the extended present, the next 20 years. Then let's take the next 40 years. The next 40 years is essentially what I call familiar futures. It is the futures that we can familiarize, that we are familiar with, through science fiction, through work in biology, through work in physics. It's the images we get from new knowledge that has come over the last 10, 15, 20 years, or it's the future that we see from science fiction. It's interesting to see, for example, how many cities are modeled on Blade Runner, right? a classical film, and there are numerous papers, books written about how many cities are modeled on Blade Runner. Now, I'll give you one city that you could not possibly imagine that it has been modeled on Blade Runner. Mecca, the holiest city in Islam, is modeled on Blade Runner. It looks like the city in Blade Runner, except it doesn't rain, and we don't have the images, because the Saudis don't think that having an image is a profoundly ridiculous thing to do, or whatever. I mean, they don't allow images. But if it's modeled on tall buildings and all that, you can actually take photographs and impose the frames of Blade Runner you discover. So we actually take images from science fiction and other places and create a future based on that. So the next 40 years, that's 20 years extended present, and 20 years after that, are familiar futures. This is where most of what we know today is being projected. Now, it's interesting that when I was listening to people talking about the future, because it is the unknown, they kept on talking about the present. In fact, they will start with history. Say, this is what has happened in history, and then this is what's happening now, and therefore it must happen in the future. Yes, in the extended present and the familiar future, yes. But after 40 years, the next 60 years is what I describe the unthought. This is the unthought future. It's the future we have not thought about because it is not possible for us to think, partly. But it is not unthinkable. It is unthought because over a framework of thought, the basic assumptions and axioms within which we work do not allow us to think about that. Now, that is the great unknown, and almost anything can happen there. You can have all the equality you want, because it takes three generations to take a change society, and 60 years, the unthought future emerges after the 30 years, when we can do virtually anything we want. So the standard model of physics could collapse within that period, and physics could be going in a totally different direction. It is the unthought of physics in that sense. It does. You need to step out of the current frameworks to think about that. And part of that unthought is thinking about the other, in a sense. And when we were talking about extended present and the futures, the question that nobody asked, actually, not true, I did ask somebody. I asked Sir Bernard Lee, now, whose future are we talking about? All these things are not in singular. There is no such thing as the future. We are talking in a framework of multiple futures. So the idea of whose future is very, very important. And the subsequent question, who benefits from this particular future, is also very, 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 very important. So for example, the big data future we were presented with, it became clear in the presentation itself that a handful of multinational companies will control everything. So the future we were being presented with ended up benefiting half a dozen multinational corporations based in Silicon Valley. Now, maybe you want that future, I don't, so I say, stuff you. What you say is rubbish. That's my stand. I'm not going to fudge about that. So, extended present, already colonized, familiar future, part of the Western conceptions of what future should like, and the unthought, where almost anything happened. So we are going towards this unknown. But as George pointed out earlier on, that if we start our journey to the future, we should understand the present. So we're starting from this place today. And today, before we begin our journey, we have to acknowledge certain things. One is that we are living in a world which is very, very complex. Almost all our problems are complex problems. And they're embedded in a network society where everything is networked. You have complexity, we have network, and we have change, which is not just getting rapid, but accelerating. So complex problems embedded in a network society with accelerating change, and we're going to get lots of positive feedback, which takes us to the edge of chaos. So that's why we are perpetually on a edge of chaos. So we are in a very specific place today where complexity and chaos and huge number of contradictions that throws up. Almost everywhere you go and you come across any particular problem, you will see that there are contradictory positions. And one can argue logically from both sides. So three C's, contradictions, chaos, and complexity, that's where we are beginning of a journey. And if you bring these three things together, I describe it as post-normal. It's a post-normal times in the sense that the conventional normal solutions that we have taken for granted do not work anymore. We have already saw that politics and governance just and democracy just does not work. We can see that capitalism and the economic system doesn't work. In Britain, we know that the National Health Service is not working. If you go to Pakistan, almost nothing seems to be working. Nothing seems to work at all in that sense. So most of the things that we've taken for granted as normal, that they will always be there and they will always serve us, are increasingly failing to serve us. So we are in a post-normal situation. So we begin our journey to this unknown from this post-normal position. Now, I just like to point out in the few minutes that I've left that there are few things associated with this journey 200 years from to extended present, familiar futures, and to the unthought, where the real changes lie, that is 40 years beyond. The two or three things. We've heard about so much advancements in knowledge. People kind of listing and giving graphs. The real reality is that every advancement of knowledge has a downside associated with it. So the more we know, it seems that the less we know. So there's an ignorance dimension associated with each of the three periods that I'm projecting into the future. The first ignorance is what we may call plain ignorance. It is the ignorance of the other, the fear of the other. This is partly ignorance, and it's also partly constructed ignorance, in the sense that people who are constructing this know the truth, they know the knowledge, but they've constructed a particular kind of ignorance to promote a particular kind of othering or a demonization of people and so on and so forth. So the first is plain old ignorance that is going to be with us for a very long time, certainly in the extended present. But there are two other types of ignorances we need to pay attention to. The second kind of ignorance, let us call it vincible ignorance, not like Saint Asylum, but vincible in the sense of the word. This is an inbuilt ignorance in the future. Suppose we change certain genes of a particular human being, right? Or introduce a particular genetic technology, we would not know the total effect of that technology for at least 20 years. It's not just the individual; it has become part of some society community. So 20 years. So we have to. This is the unknown that will remain the unknown for 20 years, after which we will be able to say something positive or negative about it. So there are certain aspects of our knowledge that have a built-in futures ignorance in it. That the answers cannot be given now. The answers can only be discovered 20, 30 years. Think of the debate about genetically modified food. You know, are they good or bad? We still do not know because they have not gone through the human system. It will take another 10, 15 years for us to come to a conclusive answer. Meanwhile, you can have papers which say they are good, you have papers which say they are bad, but actually the conclusive answer lies in the future. So this is the ignorance that is built in. It's the ignorance which we cannot remove today, but we can remove 15, 20 years from now. And then the third ignorance, the deepest ignorance of all, and that is the ignorance of the unthought. What happens if we leave the present framework and move to a totally different framework of thought, assumption about society? Notice how, despite the problems of capitalism, it is almost impossible for us to think of an alternative to capitalism. It's because there is the unthought, there is the fear. We automatically assume. We talked about democracy. Democracy is the best, is the worst system except all the others. Churchill has been quoted as you know, in this meeting. So there is an assumption, there's an unthought that there's something frightening lies outside democracy, outside capitalism, outside the kind of technological work we do. And that's the deepest ignorance of all, the ignorance that refuses to allow us to question our basic assumptions. Some of them are metaphysical, some of them about knowing, some of them about being, some of them about doing, these basic assumptions that we take for granted. And only when we question them can we actually move to the unthought. And with each ignorance, there are uncertainty associated with it. Helga Nowotny spoke very briefly about uncertainty. There is obviously the what we may call, let's keep the ocean metaphor going, what we may call surface uncertainty, which most people describe as risks. And we have a reasonably good science of risk management, although it's not very successful. And that kind of uncertainty only has a limit of the extended present. It only works within the next 20 years. Beyond that, it has no real function. And there, what we may call slightly more concerning uncertainties, kind of, which may be shallow uncertainties about changes in society, about which we have invincible ignorance, about which we can't say anything at the moment, but we want the change nevertheless, or change is happening anyway in a very rapidly kind of globalized world. So this is a kind of second order uncertainty, and there are deep uncertainties that we seldom question. Okay. Everything Maria says will happen in biology in the next few years happens. Okay, everything Professor Hurtovich says about the new biology that will happen in the next 20 years happens. Then what happens? Well, we have changed the definition of human being. What it means to be human then is transformed. I wasn't asked about it. Do you want your humanities kind of transformed? No, you weren't asked about it. It's something that happened. So if you actually change, have a profound change where the meaning of what it means to be human is transformed, the uncertainties associated are very, very deep, and nobody ever kind of raises them, let alone tries to analyze them. So, yes, let us go to the unknown. Let us explore the next 100 years. But I think it will help if we divide the next 100 years into, as I have done, into extended present, familiar futures, and the unthought. The real exciting work for me lies in the domain of the unthought, not in the extended present, not in the familiar future. But the interesting thing is that things in extended present and the familiar future could go post-normal in the sense they could become chaotic. And we know the chaos often leads either to collapse or to a new order of the system. So chaos is going to increase as we move towards this kind of post-normal century. And at the end of the day, it is not science or technology that is going to take us to the unthought. It's not even medicine. It's something called imagination and something called creativity, about which we said very little. And something that really would take us to the unthought in a safe way, where our humanity is intact, where the kind of dignity that Shireen Ebadi is talking about with social justice is intact, where the rule of law that George was mentioning, and the human rights that he was mentioning, are intact. Now, these are very big ifs, because we take these things for granted, yet they do not exist even in the present, let alone in the extended present of next 20 years or next 40 years. These things are in serious kind of seriously on the edge of chaos, of collapsing. And as we move towards the next 100 years, they will become even more chaotic and more post-normal. Most of all, what we need as the basic starting point are not just the kind of challenges that I'm concluding. Not just the challenges that Luciano mentioned, but the whole idea of ethics. We need to bring ethics right back to the center of the debate. It's ethics that will actually make or break our journey into the unknown. Thank you very much.